Today about slave resistance to the system used against Africans in the so-called New World of America. We are fortunate to be joined again by comrade Haki Shakur, who is a political activist and historian. Slavery is not an ancient system. For example, this is an interview done in the 1930s with the grandson of a slave owned by Thomas Jefferson, founder of the USA.
My name is Fountain Hughes. I was born in Charlottesville, Virginia. My grandfather belonged to Thomas Jefferson. My grandfather was 115 years old when he died. And now I am 101 years old. Some people didn't have no beds when they were slaves. You want to slip on the floor. Tied up here and tied up there. Just like a lot of wild people. We didn't know nothing. Didn't like to look in no book.
The Nazi regime put millions of people into slavery. They planned to install a racial slave system in the vast territories that they conquered for hundreds of years, based explicitly on the US model. In recent years, ISIS and other groups like it have kidnapped tens of thousands of people into slavery and sexual slavery. As shocking as this is to us now, for hundreds of years, the United States was run on the same basis. So the first question we asked Haki was to give us an idea of the size and scale of slavery in the Americas.
To get an idea of the size and the scale of slavery in the Americas, you will have to put it in the proper context and understanding the transatlantic slave trade system, starting with the fact that the transatlantic slave trade system is the biggest trafficking of humans and trading of humans to ever exist in mankind's history, starting with those European nations that pulled up to the African shores in the early 1400s, the Portuguese, the British, the Spanish, the French, the Dutch, and the Danish, who would then start a massive trading of human beings to three continents, South America, North America, and Europe. 307,000 Africans was taken to the North American continent. 765,000 was taken to Cuba. 935,000 was taken to Jamaica. And 2.7 million were taken to the Caribbean islands. South America, you had over 356,000 taken to Guyana. You had 3.1 million of Africans taken to Brazil. And then you had 92,000 taken to Argentina. And then you had 7,600 taken to Europe. Overall, there were 12 million or 12.8 million Africans taken to the Western Hemisphere. There were slave port, fort, castles set up and down the West African coast to make this slave trade more accessible for those European nations to purchase, kidnap, and trade Africans. Over a 400-year span over the Atlantic Ocean and the Middle Passage, the number of purchase by traders were considerably higher as the passage had a high death rate also. Approximately 1.2 to 2.4 million Africans dying during the voyage, and millions more would have to be in seasoning camps in the Caribbean islands after the arrival in the New World. Millions of Africans died as a result of slave raids, wars, and during transport to coast for sale for European slave traders.
What was the life of a slave like under this system?
To describe the life of an enslaved political prisoner, you have to understand that these Africans were indeed political prisoners of war from different African nations and tribes. The life of an enslaved child, an enslaved adult, or an enslaved elderly was really no difference. The conditions were harsh, extreme, inhumane, that no human being should have to endure. They worked to cultivate the fields, clear the fields, and cultivate the crops. These Africans worked from dawn until dusk under the orders of white overseers. Arriving at work at dawn, these enslaved Africans only stopped for rest and food at breakfast and lunchtime, after which they worked until nightfall. After returning to their living quarters, these enslaved Africans still had chores to do before going to bed. Enslaved Africans were whipped if they did not work hard enough or either sold off the plantation. During harvest time, slaves worked in shifts up to 18 hours a day. The female girls worked on the estates from the age of 4. Occupations for these girls between the ages of 12 and 19 varied from field work, stock work, domestic duties. These enslaved African women often worked as midwives, nurses, or housekeepers. But also across the Caribbean islands, the majority of women worked between the ages of 19 and 54, working on the fields. Housing on the plantation, slaves lived in small cottages with thatched roofs. The cottages often had earthen floors, were furnished only with a bed, a table, and a bench. The mistreatment and punishment of these enslaved Africans. White masters had to complete control over the lives of enslaved Africans, treating them like mere property. No enslaved African had rights. Plantation owners were free to act as dictators. Enslaved Africans who disobeyed or resisted, even in the small ways, were violently punished. It was not a crime to kill an enslaved African in North America, the Caribbean islands, and the South America. The lawyers and judges of the islands were indeed slave owners, so there were little interest in prosecuting for the mistreatment of enslaved Africans. The punishments handed out to enslaved Africans varied in severity. Captured runaways would be hanged or maimed. Enslaved Africans were often flogged and whipped for any wrongdoing. The number of lashes that they received depended on the seriousness of the crime that these enslaved Africans were accused of.
What were the languages, religions, customs, cultures, music that were brought over by African people to the Americas?
There were various nationals, ethnic groups of Africans that were brought over here with different languages, religions, customs, and music. Some of those nationals were Igbo people, Yoruba, Mandinka, Mande, Malian, Ashanti, Akan, Fa, Ga, Wolof, Yoruba, Angolan tribes, and many more vast ethnic groups that were brought over here. Some of the religions, customs, and music that they brought over here with them were things like the drums, dance, crops like rice, black-eyed peas, yams, various religions like Ifa, Afa, Odinani, Obeya, Voodoo, and many, many, many other indigenous African spiritual systems. In order for them to maintain any of these cultures, customs, music, and religions, they had to go into a stage of implementing things like syncretism. Syncretism was the merging of various religions, cultures, customs, and music that they had to do in guise, disguise, in secrecy, in order to maintain and hold on to these indigenous ways of lives. They had to do things like merged their gods with European gods, mixed their religion with Native, Indigenous, and European American traditions, cultures, and religions in order to maintain some kind of indigenous ways of living.
And so, what ways did Africans resist the mass kidnapping and enslavement system?
The African resistance to the capitalist system of slavery, from Africa to the Americas. The African resistance on the continent, on the West Central Coast, is rarely talked about, discussed, or taught in education systems across the world. The African resistance to slavery is very vast in multiple countries with self-defense and military units. For example, King Marimba, aka Alfonso of the Congo, set up stiff resistance and military units against slavery against the Portuguese in the 1520s. You also had in other countries, Senegal, Ghana, Benin, Nigeria, and Angola, self-defense units and strategies against slavery. In 1777, you had King Agaja of the Dahomeyan monarch in the Dahomeyan kingdom, who had a military army of females who set up stiff resistance against the Englishmen. You also had, in 1787, the Senegal King Al-Mami passed a law making it illegal for Englishmen to try to set up a slave system of trade in his country. You also had the Great Queen Nzinga of the Angola people, who had a 30-year war against the slave traders of the Portugal peoples. You also had vast resistance from peoples like the Kru and the Igbo people. You also had stiff resistance on the ships and when they got off the ships, like the Amistad Rebellion led by Senku. You also had nonviolent ways of self-defense against slavery, like with the Kru people and the Igbo people. The Kru people and the Igbo people chose suicide over a life of slavery or enslavement. The Igbo people had the Great Igbo Landing in South Carolina, where they got off the ships and then returned to the waters in suicide to escape enslavement. You also had other means of strategies against slavery that was nonviolent and violent at times. You had methods like poisoning on the plantations in Americas, where you had queens who knew how to whip up poison and poison their slave owners and slave masters in ways to escape slavery.
What were some of the most successful slave revolts and what happened during them?
The success of slave revolts, slave insurrections, slave rebellions. There were so many slave rebellions in the history of plantation slavery. Some were documented, some are undocumented. Many of these slave rebellions didn't end in success as seen by the European historians and education systems. But in our eyes, as New African people, these were bricks and steps towards our liberation. There were many, many successful slave rebellions, like the slave rebellions of the Palmares, Colombo peoples in South America that led to successful independent settlements in New African states in South America. You also had the rebellions of San Miguel de Galapo of 1526. That was a early slave rebellion in history. You had the Stono Rebellion, the Mena Conspiracy Rebellion, Gabriel Prosser's Rebellion, Nat Turner's Rebellion, and one of the largest in North America, the 1811 German Coast Uprising in Louisiana. You had the Denmark Vesey Rebellion. You also had the slave rebellions of the Seminoles, the Black Seminoles, the Gula Wars between 1835 and 1838 against the Empire of the United States of America. But the most successful rebellion of them all was the rebellion of Haiti, the Haiti Slave Rebellion, which led to the first independent black republic in history on the continent of Africa and in the diaspora, led by the Haitian enslaved peoples. You had slave rebellions also that were successful by the Maroons of Jamaica and North America that also ended up in certain aspects of independence. These individuals and brave freedom fighters would pillage plantations across the Americas, stealing weapons, food.
When Africans escaped the plantations, what did they do?
After our African ancestors escaped plantation slavery to the north, as far as Canada, and as far as south to Mexico, there were various things that these ancestors would start to do. For instance, these ancestors started to change their identity by starting with changing their names to start a new legacy and a new life for their newly found freedom and refuge from plantation slavery. Many Africans would start to set up systems of going back into plantation slavery to help free other enslaved Africans. The struggle didn't stop once many of these Africans escaped plantation slavery because they didn't want to leave their brothers or sisters behind. But the most significant and most important thing that these brothers and sisters did when they escaped slavery was they started to escape into places to set up their own independent communities and settlements in what we would call new African states, like in the Great Dismal Swamp of Virginia and North Carolina, the Great Swamps of Georgia, Mississippi, Louisiana. They would go deep into these swamps and to set up a new way of life and a way to return to their indigenous freedoms that they had before they were captured. Many of these Africans would start to set up self-defense units to defend their newly found refuge and independent places and sacred places of liberation.
What are some of the ways that this history is remembered by new African people today?
The ways our story is being remembered and continued by the new African nation inside the empire of the United States of America is actually carrying on the legacy of those ancestors who resisted, who fought back, shot back, and did everything possible to survive for us new Africans to be here today to continue to fight for what we're seeking, which is land, independence, separation from our historical oppressors, and to liberate land, and to liberate the new African nation into independence and a sovereign nation on a land and a home we can call our own. But also, in many other ways, we're continuing our story and teaching it to be remembered is through ceremonies, rituals, and just educational independence so we can tell our story to our kids, to our generations that's coming behind us, so they will too also be one with their ancestors, and to keep this story sacred and told to all the generations to come to be a part of the new African nation once the new African nation is liberated.
The United States is the land of Hollywood. Why have there been little or no movies made about successful slave resistance and revolt?
Why are these stories of resistance not being told through film inside the United States Empire? First, you have to understand that New Africans don't own the filming industry, nor do we control the educational system of the U.S. Empire. It is not in the interest of the U.S. Empire to show us our story, but to control his story. So it's conducive and productive to them to keep us controlled mentally, which is the most strategic way of keeping a people captured, keeping a colony captured, keeping a nation from becoming independent is through control of their media, of their filming industry, so future generations of Africans would not know what resistance looks like or these stories of resistance look like. So this is all set up by design for us to not be able to show our stories through their filming industries and filming companies that's owned by the capitalists and proud United States of America. It's also known that if a people know their story, they will start to see their history is not the reality for them. But if I could make a film about any story on this topic of resistance in the Americas, it would have to be about the story of Gabriel Prosser of Virginia and the Gabriel's Rebellion of 1800 in Black August, when Gabriel, an organizer at the age of 24, started to rise up and organize in the state of Virginia to liberate his brothers and sisters in Virginia. I think it's the complete story of what we're seeking as new Africans here in the empire of the United States of America, which is total independence from our oppressors. Gabriel's story was one of the first stories of example and leading by example towards what that should look like and what we should want that to be like as an independent people. Gabriel's Rebellion is a story of a hero, a freedom fighter that has been suppressed and repressed throughout the history of the United States Empire. It would inspire and spark brains and minds of future generations if this film was to be produced and shown to our people and to our people globally, to know that we were here actually trying to get free and not remain as captured political prisoners and prisoners of war of this empire. The only and few ways we can get this film made is through independent filming, support from allies, individuals who want these stories told. So if we want to get this done and to get a Gabriel Prosser film produced, we have to start pushing a mass movement of independent filming and support financing independent films for new Africans inside the empire. Free the land.
You can find more of Haki's analysis across social media. His website is newafrican77.wordpress.com.